It's kind of a deal, I think, that's reasonable, which is when your kids grow up and they get to be 16 or wherever it's legal where you live, they get the car, but they kind of have to demonstrate that they know how to drive before you let them roll around. Now, women were given the vote various points in the 19th and 20th century. I think it was Wisconsin that gave women the vote because it was really a kind of sausage fest out there. They couldn't get women out there, so they offered women the vote in order to lure women out, so thirsty men and all. And you get the vote, which is driving the ship of state, so to speak. I think, I don't know if it was explicit at the time, but certainly one of the implicit bargains for women getting the vote was that they learn about politics. Now you have this awesome responsibility. I mean, you wouldn't just want to be voting emotionally, right? You wouldn't want to just, I don't know, undermine the potential future and integrity of Europe because some irresponsible father let his child drown near Turkey. So you wouldn't want to just be emotional. And you certainly wouldn't want to just be greedy. Like, you'd have to learn politics and principles and philosophy and understand things. I'm not saying all men do, but that's kind of the deal. If you get the vote, you with great power comes great responsibility. If you get the vote, you really should learn about politics. Now, this is a little bit of an older data point, but from 2013, I don't know if it's better or worse now, but it may explain some of the voting patterns in general. See, if you don't know principles, you vote for bigger government. If you don't know property rights, if you don't know the basic reality that government is an agency of force, of coercion, of violence in society, then you're gonna more easily drift into the socialism virtue signaling. Well, why wouldn't you want poor people to have free stuff? Why wouldn't you want sick people to have free health care? Why wouldn't you want uneducated people to get free quality education? What kind of monster? All right, you know what it is, right? So if you don't understand principles, you end up making decisions based upon shallow surface emotionality. You end up being very prone and prey to pretty head former drama teachers, sophists, and so on. You have well, it's a rot that sets into the legacy of freedom. Only probably a couple hundred million men died over the course of history to deliver freedoms to the world. I'm sure that women, well, really, bone up on politics in order to exercise the franchise that men fought to give them in the most responsible fashion. If you thought that, you might not be entirely correct. So according to the data, women know less about politics than men. Now, this is not particular to any country or culture. It's worldwide. And so this is from The Guardian. Regardless of gender equality, women are less likely to know about current affairs than men. The survey findings were consistent all the way from Colombia to the UK. This is according to a survey by the Economic and Social Research Council. Women know less about politics regardless of gender equality. The report focused on 10 nations, both developed and developing, where men and women were asked questions about domestic and international news. Despite the diversity of the 10 sample countries, Australia, Canada, Colombia, Greece, Italy, Japan, Korea, Norway, and the UK and the US, women answered fewer questions correctly than men in every single country. Big survey participation, 10,000 participants took part in the survey, tested their knowledge of broadcast, print, and web journalism. They were asked a combination of questions based on hard and soft news reports, including recent international events. The hard news questions pertained to topics such as national unemployment, while soft news related to sports personalities and celebrity scandals. I guess that's news. The level of gender equality in the nation survey was based on the World Economic Forum's Global Gender Gap Index ratings. So the professor, James Curran, was surprised to find that gaps in political knowledge are wider in countries that have done the most to promote gender equality. Ha! Fascinating. So the more that women are given privileges, well, first they're given equality, then they're given privileges because the revolution never knows when to stop whenever the government is involved. So the more equality and privileges women get, the less they know about politics. So the gender gaps in Norway, the UK, and the US are as large or larger than the gaps in South Korea and Japan. So what's the gap? It's pretty important. Women's scores of political knowledge in the UK, the US, and Canada were more than 30% lower on average than men, whereas in Greece, Italy, and Korea, women's average scores were only 20% lower. The UK positioned at 18 out of 135 in the gender equality rankings, while Korea is placed at 108. Wow, fantastic. What a whole series of civilization-ending data points, right? So if you look at the UK, it's 18 out of 135, near the top of gender equality, and women scored more than 30% lower on average than men in terms of knowledge of the news and politics. And Korea is 108th in gender equality, way down, but women knew more about politics relative to men than they did in the US, UK, and Canada. So there is some research to say the frequency with which people watch the news on television plays a role in gender gaps. Apart from Colombia and the US, more people watch TV news. The more people watch TV news, the better informed they tend to be. I would question that data point now. What is it, the old saying? If you read the newspaper, if you don't read the newspaper, you're uninformed. If you read the newspaper, you're misinformed. Watching, reading, and listening to the news tend to be more male activities, particularly in Canada, Norway, UK, and the US. Age is also a factor in women's interest in political affairs. The study found that women acquire political knowledge much later in their lives than men, regardless of a country's gender equality status. It seems so. It seems, this is a professor, a co-researcher on the report, it seems that gaps in exposure to media are related to the gaps of knowledge between men and women. The gender bias of hard news content in all countries plays an important role in gender gaps and underlines a serious lack of visibility of women in TV and newspaper coverage. Yes, that's right. That's right. Journalist Kathy Newman recently raised this issue in her blog, where she wrote that all broadcast newspaper editors in the UK are male, while female journalists have to fight to get their voices heard in the newsroom. Okay, tiny rant time. What is this obsession with, I need my voice to be heard? You've got to have, I want to have a voice. They've taken my voice. I don't have a voice. I need a voice. I don't care about your voice. You shouldn't care about mine. I don't care. How about instead of wanting your voice to be heard, just being right about things? You know, it's amazing how many people will listen to you. I mean, this channel is proof of that. It's amazing how many people will listen to you if you're right about a whole bunch of stuff. So instead of saying, well, I need my voice to be heard, it's like, why don't you just be right and people will gravitate towards your, quote, voice because it's right. But saying, I need my voice to be heard just seems to be a synonym for respect my opinions even if they're wrong. Respect my arguments even if there's no data or rationality. And when you say, well, you're wrong, well, you're denying my voice. It's like, well, no, you're denying your voice by not putting the work in to make your arguments empirical and rational. Now, of course, when it comes again, this is back to the IQ bell curve. So women are slightly lower on average with regards to IQ, but this is particularly true at the higher edges of IQ. So like in the very top reaches of IQ, there are like 10 men for every woman there, like even higher. And at the very highest level, there's pretty much no women at all. So to become a broadsheet newspaper editor requires extraordinarily high IQ. Women are just going to tail off. Now, where women are excellent, which is in terms of writing and fiction and so on, women do just as well and sometimes better than men. But with regards to this really high IQ, high ambition, high testosterone stuff, you're just going to get a lot of men. I bet you if you're normalized by IQ, maybe even by testosterone, you're going to find that it's all perfectly fair and perfectly even. But you see, this is interesting as well, right? Because what happens is a deficiency among women is found, right? And it's immediately, the blame is placed on men, right? It's almost like you can't fight this fundamental impulse, right? So women are uninformed relative to men, significantly, like a third or so. And they've also gelled all this stuff together. Like celebrity gossip is followed a lot more by women than by men, whereas hard news is followed more by men than by women. I'd love to see the data of just the hard news. It could be like a 50% drop. I mean, who knows, right? But it's going to be more, because they blended in all of this girl-friendly stuff or woman-friendly stuff. I mean, go to the women's section of some website. I mean, to me, it's like an alien planet of of gooey tentacle-based feels. But this is, women are voting and they're far less informed than men. Far less informed than men. Now, can anyone say, well, you know, it's really the job of women to take the responsibility of voting in a democracy or a republic seriously and up their game and really start to, no, you see, nobody can say that. Well, I can say it. Of course, it's what women should do. But I'm happily married, so it's different. But it's just one of these inevitable things. No one can say, women, you got the vote. You need to start driving without your blindfolds. You need to start driving properly. You need to become basically informed. And listen, you could just do this in your own life. Just sit down and chat with women that you know about basic politics, about what the state is and what current affairs are and how laws are passed and all that. And just talk to men. Talk. You can do your own, right? Find out. And inevitably, though, when a deficiency, a significant deficiency in women, women tend to vote more for the left and women are more uninformed or less informed, better way to put it. Women vote for the left. Women vote for bigger government, particularly single moms and single women. Women who are dependent upon their husband's income tend to be more conservative because they don't want the government taking the resources from their family, whereas women who don't have a husband rely on the state for what husbands used to provide and therefore want bigger and bigger government. And so here's a massive problem. We had creeping socialism in the West. We've got massive amounts of emotionality. And a lot of it has to do with women being uninformed. It's a worldwide phenomenon. And it's actually, the more equality and privileges women have, the less informed they are about politics. It's a huge problem. Now, rather than say, ladies, you've got cars, so you really should spend some time learning how to drive more. No, see, it's men's fault. It's men's fault for not promoting women. Women, you see, can't understand the news unless it's read to them by a woman. Come on. Isn't that insane? I cannot possibly receive philosophy instruction from anybody who's not bald, whose forehead does not verily resemble, depending on the lighting, either the red planet or a speckled ostrich egg. I simply can't do it if you don't have blue eyes. I mean, come on. This in-group preference is insane. And this idea, this is a way of excusing. Well, women, they're uninformed because women aren't reading them the news or women aren't writing articles. It's like, well, I thought we were all equal. Well, why should it matter? Oh, unless women have a special perspective than this sort of subsonic bat signal that only other women can hear, in which case we're not equal and not compatible in terms of objectivity, right? So, again, huge deficiency and irresponsibility on the part of women. You got the vote. You need to learn this stuff. Sorry. I'm sorry. I know it can be annoying, but we go visit your mom and you have to learn about politics. But when this kind of deficiency is revealed, what happens? Boom! Immediately, unconsciously, without interruption, without pause for thought, without reflection. The fault is not that women are uninformed, but men are sexist. And thus more privileges will be given to women when we need to hire more women, blah, blah, blah. Which means, according to the data, women will become even less informed, which means more privilege for women, more unjust privilege for women, which means less knowledge about politics, which means probably the end of us all. Well, no, we can turn it around, can't we? Wake up, Maggie, I think I got something to say. So identity politics is just a modern form of religion, but without the moral self-restraint, because you have, of course, your angels and your devils and your creation myths and your worshipping and so on. And the invention of the sort of white working class as the fundamental devilry of the modern leftist movement is not that surprising. It's happened over and over again throughout history. In the Russian Revolution, it was the kulaks, like the rich peasants, the people who worked hard and who were good at farming, and through their efficiency in farming had managed to accumulate more and more land, which is how you get economic productivity to grow. You put the, or you allow the market to place the means of production in the hands of those best able to maximize their use. And if you can get double the crops out of a particular field, then you can bid more to buy that field because you'll gain more profit, and that's how you accumulate. And it kind of comes and goes, right? I mean, it's called rags to riches to rags in three generations. Or it's an old Arab proverb. My grandfather rode a camel. My father rode a Cadillac. I ride a Lamborghini. my child shall ride a Cadillac and my grandchild shall ride a camel. It comes and goes, right? I mean, it's the cumulus, the bell curve of the accumulation of resources and then the regression to the mean, which means if you're smart and ambitious, your kids genetically are going to be slightly less smart and ambitious than you and so on, right? And so this is how things should work, but the accumulation of, in a free market environment, the accumulation of the means of production into the hands of the most competent and the hardworking, because people don't understand the role of genetics and IQ and the bell curve and so on, people just get mad. And they say, well, that guy who has all of this land, he's just an exploiter and he's a bourgeois and he's a bad guy, he's a capitalist, and we're going to go and tear the land from him and distribute it to the peasants, and then everybody just ends up starving to death, right? So this is the typical. It's a sad thing that happens. You get freedom. Freedom allows the means of production to accumulate to those best able to maximize their productivity. And then this creates inequalities of wealth, which then the leftists use to widen the seam of discontent and hatred. And then the government comes in to fix all of this it causes the entire economy to self-destruct. We see this happening in Venezuela now, where children are starving to death in hospitals, for God's sakes. And this cycle is really horrible. So for the leftists, they need their devil, right? They know, the Christians have their devil already, so they don't need, they have Satan, they have their devil already, so they don't need to invent merely human devils. But the leftists, who are a secular religion, they need their devil, and so they create their devil. They used to just create it in class, right, in terms of the working class versus the capitalist class and so on. And class is a completely artificial division, of course, but now what they've done is they have given up on class because it didn't really work so well. They've given up to some degree on gender because the gender pay gap and so on has been debunked so many times that women make less because they work less, because they choose to have kids, because they choose to work part-time. And it's the result of the wonderful choice that feminism has provided that women end up earning less. On the plus side, they earn more than when they stayed at home completely, because white, evil Western capitalists hadn't invented labor-saving devices for women to liberate them from endless drudgeries of cooking and cleaning and laundry and so on. And so they can't really do it by class anymore. They can't really do it by gender anymore. So now they do it by race. Right now they split by race. And because different races have different IQs, and IQ is largely genetic, and because IQ is strongly predictive of economic success, the differences in racial outcomes in a free market are, well, if you normalize by IQ, they vanish. They just vanish. And so they have to invent all of this evil, white, racist stuff to cover up basic differences between the races in terms of IQ. And so in America, like a truly unprecedented thing has happened. I touched on this recently in a call-in show. Let's go into a bit more detail here. So the American Midwest, like what they call flyover country, the Rust Belt and so on, there's been incredible economic decay. And everyone says, oh, well, you see, it's because all of these manufacturing jobs just mysteriously ended up or inevitably ended up in other countries. How can America compete with Mexico? How can America compete with China? And it's like, but it's nonsense. Do you not think that actors are cheaper in Mexico than they are in Hollywood? Do you not think that computer programmers are cheaper in Mexico than they are in Silicon Valley? So how on earth is there still a Hollywood industry and a Silicon Valley industry? If it's cheaper to make movies in Borneo or wherever, right, in Somalia, then why is it? Because you're supposed to have advantages based on education, based on efficiency, based on infrastructure, based on a wide variety of factors that's supposed to allow you to outcompete other people. Do you think that there are actors willing to take less than Julia Roberts is for a movie, or Brad Pitt or whoever, right? Of course. I mean, Brad Pitt, what is he, $15 million a movie? Do you think there's no actress in the world who'd be willing to work for less than $15 million to be the lead in a movie? Of course there are. So why does Brad Pitt get paid? Why does he get paid so much? I mean, there are actors in Mexico who are much cheaper. It's nonsense, right? It's because, well, it's a wide variety of things, but it's increased unionization drove up costs too much. It is because government education has not kept pace with the information revolution. So government education has gotten really terrible. Also because there has been this affirmative action and diversity stuff, which means non-whites have to get hired. And again, for reasons of the IQ bell curve, which affects women as well as races, this means that you're going to get less competent people on average in charge of things or working, and this is a huge problem as well. Massive increased taxes, all of the economic dislocations that result from the welfare state, the destruction of families. Also, horribly anti-male family courts have meant that men have less desire to get married, less desire to be fathers and so on, which, you know, when do you get your two big jumps in ambition as a man? Number one, when you get married, and number two, when you have children, because when you get married, you may live in a small place, but your wife very quickly will want a bigger place because she wants to have kids in particular. And then when you have kids, if your wife stops working, you get even more ambitious. Without wives and children, what do men do? Well, they pump and dump. They, you know, troll women, maybe just for sex. They play a lot of video games. They stay home. They work part time. They blog. They, you know, but they do. They don't go out and build companies. They don't go out and compete at the marketplace. So this sort of flyover country, which turned out to be strong supporters of Trump, because Trump is actually listening to the destroyed particular white male populations in those regions. And people haven't really figured this out. So, like, what was it, last month, 50,000 new manufacturing jobs in America? How is that possible? I mean, remember Obama said, hey, man, those jobs aren't coming back. What is Trump going to do, wave a magic wand? Well, I guess for Obama, the leftist, the free market is a kind of magic. Well, it's a black magic or an evil magic, I guess, from his perspective. And so how is it possible that these economic jobs are returning? When Trump cuts red tape, when Trump aims to lower corporate taxes, how is this possible? Well, because, I mean, it is the government that is driving these jobs overseas. It is not a matter of the free market. Do people, I mean, it's weird, just people have no intelligence for this stuff. I guess it's all propaganda and so on, but do people not think that labor in the 19th century was cheaper in India? You know, the world economy, about 100 years ago, the world economy, we think this internationalism or this multi-country corporatism is something new. Of course it's not. I mean, you had a whole British Empire where you had a significant amounts of free trade. Hell, all the way back to the Roman Empire, you had significant amounts of free trade throughout the empire. And so the idea that this is new internationalism, do people not think that there were cheaper workers somewhere in the world in the 19th century, yet still America was the economic powerhouse of the Western world over the late 19th and 20th century. I mean, it's just weird. It's just, well, because people don't want to, I mean, the left want to destroy the free market. They want to destroy the free market and they want to destroy Christians, as they always have throughout history. I mean, just look at the French Revolution. I mean, look at the Russian Revolution. What do? They kill the capitalist class and they kill the priestly class. This is as predictable as a very red, bloody sunrise. And so they're coming back because you have a businessman in charge of the economy rather than a community organizer, pseudo professor. I mean, this is ridiculous, right? I mean, it's nonsense. So now what's happening, so there's several decades, the American Midwest, this economic decay. And what has this done? Well, people are bored, they're lonely, they're lost, their lives have no purpose. And they're not active. You know, when you're unemployed, you're not that active. So it's more likely you're going to injure yourself. And then you get prescribed opioids, or maybe you just start taking them because you're depressed and anxious. What's happened is there is this opioid crisis in the United States. And finally, somebody, I guess of some prominence, has put two and two together and got the obvious four. Nobel laureate Angus Deaton noticed a staggering increase in white mortality rates for people aged 50 to 54. And put the links to this below. This is a Princeton economist who worked with his wife, Ann Case. Mortality rates were rising for working-aged white Americans since 1999. And that really is quite something. They're looking for something. They're trying to figure out why. Why? So people between aged 45 to 54, and even more between 50 and 54, there was a decline in mortality, white mortality. And this was astounding. This decline in mortality for about 100 years, right? People living longer, decline in mortality, had stopped and even reversed itself. And that is really quite astonishing. Normally, this only happens during a time of plague or epidemic or war for these death rates to jump, certainly over the past century. And what they looked in a bunch of different places and they found out a lot of these deaths, most of these deaths, are tied to what are called deaths of despair. Alcohol, suicide, opioids. And this is astonishing. So middle-aged white men are killing themselves directly through suicide or indirectly through substance abuse. And that is really quite astonishing. And if you look at people, I mean, I know that sort of the indigenous people to North America, right, what are called the Indians, that they have a particular susceptibility to alcoholism because they lack the enzymes to eliminate alcohol as efficiently as Europeans from their systems. But if you look at substance abuse among people whose culture is destroyed or whose environment is destroyed and who are put in these sort of welfare state farms of reservations, it's pretty wretched. And the same thing is happening to white middle-aged males in particular. And this whole way of life is, I mean, if you're a white man in your 50s, it's funny, you know, because after I was an entrepreneur, I took some time off to write and I put my job applications out there. And I mean, I have really, really great skills. I mean, I was a coder. I ran an R&D department. I did sales. I did marketing. I negotiated contracts. I mean, I had a lot of really, really good business skills. And I'd sold to, I don't know, probably 15% of the Fortune 500 companies, maybe 20% of the Fortune 500 companies, systems ranging from, you know, $50,000 to well over a million. And I really was very good in business. And I remember thinking, I wonder why I'm not getting more calls. And it took me a little while to realize that it was because I was a white male and people had their diversity quotas. And Scott Adams has talked about the same thing when he worked at various companies, that people just said, no, we're not promoting white males anymore. So you're going to have to go and do something else. And it is a bitter thing. It is a bitter thing. White males built the West, and now white males are excluded from the economic life of the West in many ways. And there has been, among sort of white working class males, there's been wage stagnation for probably about half a century now, like 50 years. And if you don't have a university degree, which is itself a proxy for an IQ test, although much more manipulable than an IQ test is, median wages for people without a university degree has actually been going down. And this is pretty horrendous stuff. So this tie-in of the economic destruction of the middle class white male, combined with the sort of suicide, explicit or implicit suicide death, the rising mortality, it really is astonishing. You know, for black non-Hispanics, mortality is going down. For Hispanics, mortality is going down. They're living longer. For all white non-Hispanics, it's creeping up. For white non-Hispanics with high school or less, it's going up extraordinarily, extraordinarily, more than 20-25%. Since the late 90s. If this was any other group, of course, this is the horrendous racism and sexism that white males are experiencing. If it was any other group, if black women were the only group in society where their mortality was increasing, people would be going insane. But because it's white males, well, it's allowed. Because those who cry racism the most tend to be the most racist. You stole my heart.
Well, there's another issue too that goes along with identity politics to some degree here, that this stratification of society is starting to reflect. Because, you know, I pointed out earlier that the best predictor of long-term life success economically is intelligence and conscientiousness. But that also means that our culture is stratifying meritocratically. And there's some things about this that we really have to take seriously. And this is where some of the uglier elements of science become germane. So IQ is a particularly ugly aspect of science because the IQ literature reveals that which no one would want to be the case, which is that there are profound and virtually irremediable differences in people's cognitive performance, and that those differences have a very solid biological and heritable basis. No one wants to hear that. They don't want to hear that it's biological. They don't want to hear that it's heritable. They don't want to hear it's permanent. They don't want to hear that it's irremediable. and that it actually has a practical consequence. And no wonder they don't want to hear it.
Well, and even worse, they don't want to hear that it differs between genders and ethnicities. That is, to me, one of the most painful things that I've ever learned in my life, is this kind of information. It is one of the great heartbreaks when it comes to the dream of pure egalitarianism. And that is, I think, even harder. It's an even harder pill for people to swallow.
Yeah, well, the gender differences in IQ look relatively trivial, but there are differences in ethnicity that don't look trivial. The Ashkenazi Jews, for example, have on average a 15-point advantage over the rest of the Caucasian population, which is sufficient to account for their radical overrepresentation in positions of authority and influence and productivity. You know, and I am, to just get me, to just so that it's absolutely clear, I am not saying that's a bad thing. I'm saying there's a real reason for it that no one wants to contend with.
Well, okay, and it's so particularly, for the Ashkenazis, it's particularly focused on language abilities. And this reflects their, quote, overrepresentation, although if you normalize by IQ, it's not the case in the arts, in novel writing, in speech writing, and so on. Ashkenazi Jews don't have a significantly strong advantage in spatial reasoning, which is one of the reasons why you'll hear a lot about Jewish writers, but not a lot about Jewish engineers. That talent seems to have spread to the East Asians in particular, who have, this is why, you know, 40% of Google's workforce is East Asian, because there are these biological differences. And this is something that has been so strenuously avoided since, I guess, the bell curve first came out 20 odd years ago. And I think the consequences of avoiding it, it's, you know, it's the old thing, give you a short term benefit, but the long term catastrophes, I think, are still accumulating.
So one of the problems with the stratification is that, okay, so let me give you an example here. It's illegal in the United States to induct anyone in the armed forces who has an IQ of less than 83. And the reason for this is that despite the fact that the armed forces has been desperate for bodies since its inception and is still desperate, and in peacetime and in wartime, and that the armed forces has been used as a social mechanism for moving people out of the underclass into the lower middle class, let's say. So, and I'm pointing that out just to state forthrightly that the armed forces, above all, had every reason not to want this to be the case. They determined after approximately 100 years of study that anyone with an IQ of 83 or less couldn't be trained to do anything that wasn't positively counterproductive in the armed forces. And that should actually, that should send a shudder of terror through everyone's heart, because an IQ of 83 puts you in the bottom 10% of the population. That's one in 10 people. And we're building a very cognitively complex society. And in that cognitively complex society, there's less and less room for the gainful employment of people who don't have the capacity to contend with cognitive complexity.
And if the army could train them and increase things and change things, to me, IQ is similar to height. You know, there's some environmental factors, but you can't make someone taller than their genetics allow as a whole. And so if the army could change that IQ, they'd have a massive incentive to do so, but nobody knows how to do it on any perpetual basis.
We've also seen repeated attempts by scientists and let's call them technical engineers, to try to produce exercises that would increase IQ. And basically the data is pretty clear, and it's also dismal. If you train people on cognitive tasks, complex cognitive tasks, you can generally increase the degree to which they can perform a specific cognitive task immensely. So they, with practice, and you see this with video games because they're complex cognitive tasks, you can get unbelievably good at a video game. Even something like a maze game, which is quite tightly associated with intelligence as a measurement. Like if you use maze performance as a measurement of IQ, it's pretty tightly associated with IQ. But despite that, that kind of training does not produce an increment in actual IQ, in general intelligence. And even if you train people across a bunch of different cognitive domains intensely, you don't get any generalization to IQ. And that's such a disappointing finding, because what you'd really hope, especially with computational technology, is that you could train people intensely to utilize their cognitive resources, you know, using specific training exercises, and get a general increment, just like if you train weights, you're going to get a general increment in strength. Doesn't happen. So we have a really profound problem that, again, no one's willing to talk about, and that's that cognitive stratification of society. And of course, that was laid out to some degree in the bell curve back in the 1990s. So, but But see, if on the liberal end, everybody wants to believe that everyone's the same and that you can just train anyone to do everything. And then on the conservative end, everyone wants to believe that if you just got off your ass and looked for a job, there'd be a position for you. And unfortunately, that's just simply not the case. And so there's something about that that, well, I don't have a solution to that, but I at least can point out the problem.
IQ is a very good predictor of health. It's a predictor of longevity. It's a predictor of resistance to post-traumatic stress disorder. It's a predictor of, obviously, occupational status. It's a predictor of educational success. It's a predictor of income. It's a very powerful predictor. And here's another way of conceptualizing its effect. So imagine that you could choose how you were going to be when you were born. This is in North America, because it's going to vary by society, at least to some degree. You get to be born into a family that's at the 95th percentile for wealth, or you get to be born at the 95th percentile for intelligence. Who's better off at the age of 40? And the answer is the person who picks being born with an IQ in the 95th percentile at birth. It's a more powerful predictor of long-term life outcome than familial wealth. So, and it shows up everywhere. Like, one of the things we did recently was look at disgust sensitivity. We're going to talk a little bit about that when we talk about conscientiousness, because orderly people seem to be more sensitive to disgust than disorderly people. That seems to be why they're orderly. But the higher you are in IQ, the less disgust sensitive you are. Now, we don't know exactly why that is. Maybe it's because, you know, maybe you could make the inference that IQ is in related in some way to the physiological integrity of the cortex, you know, rather than the limbic system, which, you know, is the source of, say, emotions and motivations. And the more powerful it is, the more inhibitory capacity it has over the more fundamental motivations and emotions. You could make that case. The problem is that intelligent people don't necessarily seem to be any less impulsive. So, and you can have a pretty vicious personality disorder that's characterized by extremely disorganized behavior and a complete inability to put long-term plans into operation and still have a high IQ. So, what are the things we really can't figure out? It's just a hell of a thing to try to figure out. Is like the relationship between IQ and industriousness is zero. And that just makes no sense to me, because most of the brain models are predicated on the idea that your ability to engage in long-term planning is a factor that's associated with intelligence. But then industrious people seem to not only engage in long-term planning, they seem to do it right, so that if they're more industrious, they put their plans into operation, then the plans actually work. But it's not correlated with IQ. So then I can't figure out, well, obviously, the industrious person, in some way, is able to regulate their own behavior. You know, they're not procrastinating, for example. And you'd think that the ability to not procrastinate would be a cognitive feature, but it doesn't seem to be. And we have no idea what makes people industrious, and we can't figure it out. So it's this incredibly potent predictor. It's just about as powerful as IQ. And we have no idea what it is. So if you have a smart idea about that and you want to pursue it, like, feel free, because there's a big mystery there that no one's been able to crack, and we've been at it for a long time and have had almost no success. You know, we had people do things like, we'd give them sentences of N's, M's, and U's sort of randomly distributed, and then we'd have them count the U's, you know, like a whole page of sentences. They're not sentences, they're just strings of letters. Count the U's. How useless, you know? You'd think that someone industrious would do that better. It's like, they don't. That's an IQ test. The people who can count the U's faster have higher IQs. Almost everything that you would do that would, where it has to do with manipulation of abstractions of any sort, even something that basic, seems to be fundamentally associated with IQ. People with higher IQs have slightly bigger heads if you control for body size. They have slightly bigger brains if you control for body size. The axons on their neurons are a bit thicker, so the the electrical messages seem to travel a little bit more efficiently. They are slightly faster in simple reflex tests. So it goes right down to the level of, because they're simple reflex, light goes on, push a button. There's not many neurons mediating that response, you know, chains of neurons. There's only a few neurons communicating so that you can do that. But even at that relatively simple processing level, IQ is associated with speed. So there's a physiological component. You're less likely to develop Alzheimer's disease if you have a high IQ. And maybe that's because your brain is just more robust, you know, so you could sustain damage, say, of up to 50% of your brain, and you wouldn't even show it if you have a sufficiently high IQ. Whereas if you're on the bottom end of the IQ distribution, you seem to be much more susceptible to physiological damage. Nutrition is a big predictor of IQ variation. So, and a lot of that's been hammered out of modern societies, you know. So 150 years ago, people's IQ was pretty tightly associated with their nutritional status. But now, you know, there are very few people in North America who don't have enough to eat, even though there's some variation in quality of diet. And that's flattened out a lot of the cultural variability in intelligence. Intelligence is an interesting concept. It's very controversial. In fact, one of the things that continually happens over and over again in psychology is that psychologists discover all sorts of new kinds of intelligence. And, you know, the biggest two proponents of that sort of thing, I suppose, were Bob Sternberg, who came up with this thing he called practical intelligence, and then Howard Gardner, who came up with the theory of multiple intelligences, which had a very large effect on educational psychology when the theory was first proposed. And that's not saying much, because generally speaking, it's very difficult to find a discipline that's more susceptible to fads than educational psychology. And as far as I can tell, generally speaking, each fad is worse than the previous one. So, you know, Gardner posited that, I think there were seven or eight different intelligences: linguistic, musical, logical, mathematical, spatial, body kinesthetic, intrapersonal, and interpersonal. And people talk about emotional intelligence and they talk about practical intelligence. And as far as I'm concerned, all of that's complete rubbish. And there's technical reasons for that. I mean, there's technical and philosophical reasons for that. The first thing is, you can't just mess up a word. You know, the whole point of having a word is so that it defines some things, it describes some things, and doesn't describe other things, right? And so you can make the word intelligence account for whatever you want. So you can say that the ability to dance is a form of intelligence. But the problem with that is you blur out the word so badly you can't tell what it means anymore. And I would also point out, we had perfectly good words for those major intelligences. We called them talents. And so it's perfectly reasonable to make a distinction between a talent and intelligence. Now, you might say, well, how the hell do you know the difference? Like, if things look similar to some degree, then how do you know if they're the same or different? Well, that's exactly what you do when you do the construct validity process. So let's say you rated a number of people on their dancing ability, and then you rated a number of people on their ability to multiply two-digit numbers in their head quickly. Well, then, you see, technically, if both of those were intelligences, then the people who could dance better could multiply two-digit numbers faster in their head. And that they would be slightly See, that's what happens when I don't have any Diet Coke. So anyways, if intelligence was the right word to subsume both of those, then what you'd see is there would be a high correlation. The people who were good dancers would also be the ones who could multiply most rapidly. And, I mean, multiply in their head. But you're not going to be able to extract out a single factor like that. It's just not the case that those things associate like that. So, for something to be one phenomena, the things that it... Obviously, I've talked too much this semester. All the things that are subsumed under that definition have to be correlated, and highly correlated. Because otherwise they're not the same thing. It's the definition of the same thing. Now, IQ is a very peculiar construct, a very unique construct from a psychological perspective, but also more generally from a social science perspective, because IQ has the most predictive validity of anything ever discovered in the social sciences, period.